That was a random disconnect. That was a random disconnect. Cool. Anyway, we're back in the game. So, yeah, I was about to maybe write some comments onto here that that white space. Remove interval after 5 minutes. So 1, 2, 3 more zeros. Yes, 1, 2, 3 zeros. Correct. The initial timer will be this much. And we have a working timer, I think. I'm just thinking here about those quotes within the backticks. If there was a better way to write this one, but anyway, let's not bike shit into that. So that's gonna be a timer. Let's look at the requirements again. We don't need those docs. So 5 minute timer. Should I do that? 5 minute timer. So some animation in the background. This is the other JavaScripty thingy. The rest are kind of like more artsy thingies and somewhat easier to tackle. So not really very interesting, but I would like to do the animation next. And I want to use a combination of something procedurally generated. Maybe using this as a as an inspiration. No, but definitely not not that fast and not looking like that. And something similar to this one. So can we create some, like some sort of a canvas element, or basically use the entire app dev, and then we could either approach this using a canvas tag in which we could actually do proper drawing, or we could just make those shapes with CSS hacks. Basically, if we're gonna be using only both, and probably I'm gonna start with only one shape to start with, we can just start off with the border radius 50% and go from there. Okay, let's see, let's see. Let's start. So, I wonder if that clock is gonna be triggering me, so maybe I should stop it for the time being while developing. So let's create a ball, one ball to start with. So create a timer DOM node. Here is our, oops, my bad, initiate count DOM timer. So I wonder if it's gonna also start making sense extracting things into functions at some point, but we can do that later. Let's create a ball component. Ball base, whatever, because we might need the ball name later. And we're probably gonna generate off of this ball base many different such elements, so we need something to work with. So this is just gonna be a div. Can use a span or whatever. That div will need some styling to it, so I can either write the styles in here, or I can just give it a class and write them up there in the CSS. Let's do that. Cool. Well, the most important thing is that border radius should be 50%, so we actually get rounded corners all around. And oh, what happened with my timer? I think my timer just bugged out. I wonder if some of the logic here got skipped. Let's bike shed just a little bit onto it. If that, for whatever reason, if the set timeout ran just a bit quicker before the next iteration of this, maybe it actually skipped it, which is funny one, because this is 3 seconds is 3000 milliseconds. So is that 300 seconds? No. I think I'm retarded. That should be it. Now it should work, hopefully. Because 300 and then with 3 zeros, so 300,000. Yeah. I had one extra zero there. Let's mount that bow element. Just for the sake of testing. Bow base. We are going to need to give it a width and a height, and those will need to be programmatically given, so. And a background color, probably as well. So we're probably gonna be better off doing the styles here. Let's see if we can update the styles like this. Width will be 25 pixels to start with. Height will be the same. And background color will be something darker. Yeah, so I don't think, yeah, I never tried that one before, so I guess it doesn't work. You have to do it. Okay, here we have a ball. Let me see. Without any movement to start with, we need to have a few. Few things with the ball, a few properties. I wonder if we should write a class for that. Let's see. I don't think we need to do that. I think we're gonna stick to datasets, data attributes. So basically, let's describe a bool. Create a bool component. Bool properties with height. Those will need to be random generated. And because we actually want those will actually always be equal to each other, so we can encapsulate them by one property called radius. This will be basically data attribute, data radius. Then we're gonna have a color, obviously. That doesn't need more explanation. We need to come up with some sort of a, well, let's go with completely random colors to start with, and after that we'll see what we're gonna do. And then radius and a color. That determines the size. Time to disappear. So. Time to live, maybe. I don't know what to call it. timer again. Too many timers in this code base. Yeah, maybe time to live is good. So that could be something like 2 seconds. And then it's basically gonna fade out and get removed from the DOM. Which means that we need you need to manage that somehow, but we'll see how. Yeah, let's go with these for now. And see what happens next. So one way to avoid adding another interval to the code is to reuse the same interval to generate the balls. Of course, that doesn't allow us to do like more randomy thingies. Like, we will need to be spawning balls every second instead of random durations of time. But we can start with that for prototyping purposes. Hmm. We want to maintain a constant of roughly around, I don't know, let's say 20 balls to start with. And so every second, we can count them, we can check. Yeah, that's also one way. Basically, the safest check to the safest check to see if how many balls we have at any given time. Is to do it in here. So let's say we do this like every one second. We are gonna update the UI, sure. Also here we can do a function that generate balls. And let's call that function. Now JavaScript will scope hoist that function up, even if I write it somewhere down here. So let's write the function here. Now this is the function that we want to run. Well, and so this function, the first thing it's gonna do, if it's gonna check if the current amount of, you can even get them by class name, of balls elements is more than 25. Whatever, we're just gonna return, otherwise we're gonna console log hi. Now every second this is gonna be generating one ball until it hits 25, at which point it's gonna stop. Cool thing is that this check is kind of dynamic, so let's see, it should work good with, well, based on how we generate the balls and stuff. Let's see. Now it should kind of stop at 25, right? Oh, that's a pickle. Oh, because why? Keeps getting, but why doesn't it return? Can you do? Missing. Of course. Why do I have 100 of those brackets? Nobody knows. Documented killed elements by class name. Boom. Dot length. Why is the? Oh, because I'm actually not adding the. I'm not. Oh my god, I'm retarded. I need to actually append some. So let's generate balls. first generate. Well, of course you could also just do it here preventatively, and then ball base. Oh, yeah, because we need to move the entire create generate boss will be. I wonder if populate is a better word for that, but we can leave it generate for now. We are going to extract one more method here, one more function to create a ball. Which will be a function, and we're going to take this whole thing where we create the ball component with all of its specifics into its own function here, and we're gonna call create ball from within we can append to the app an element that is being returned from this create ball component. So here we can basically, after we do all the configurations, we can return the ball base, which returns that div. And here we're gonna append create ball return value. Sure, those will have to be like positioned absolute, some simple CSS stuff. But yeah, now let's see if this will actually stop at 25, because it should. So it stopped at 26. Okay. Yeah, because yeah, obviously the zero. Yeah, that's 26. Well, anyway, let's not get into that. But that's how many of those there are, and in this case, just return. Don't generate anything. So these will be position absolute, and they will need some values. For left and right. Within a certain... Not sure I like that. But yeah, we will need to get the current window width. For those values, so time to live, we're gonna have here also when we create the ball, we're gonna have to specify position left, maybe even. I even wonder if we should just name this data left and data top. So offset from the left and offset from the top, and this will need to be calculated. Well, obviously it's going to be from 0 to window screen window. Is it screen? I want to say screen X, maybe, not sure. That seems reasonable. Oh, that's not reasonable. That's not. That's the entire screen. No. Was it offset something? No. Off. Page X offset? Is that it? No? How did you get is it in the window object? Is it? It's not on document, right? Let's Google that real quick. What could it be? Window screen size. Screen dot width. Oh god. And yeah, it's technically it's window screen width. That also doesn't seem right. That's not it. That's not it. Inner width? Window inner width? Oh my god. Window inner width? Yes, that's more like it. That looks like 600 something pixels. Yeah. Cool. All right. Oof. So yeah. Data left will be value between 0 and that minus the radius of the ball if we don't want the ball to be off the screen. If we don't care about the ball being cut off, then we don't have to do those checks. And this is a sloppy thing, so we're gonna start off without doing the checks. Window inner width, and yeah, pretty much the top value will be between 0 and window dot inner height. Okay, so those are our ball properties that we need to work on. And let's refresh this and see what up. So now all the balls are stacking in the middle here. I just need to give them some random styles, basically, based on those values. Whenever we run the function that creates the ball with an upper limit of 25, that's going to give us the 25 balls, and after that we're going to work on how to actually fade the balls out with the time to live. So this is going to be the last property we're going to work on. And then whenever we remove a certain amount of balls, that should allow us to generate more balls. Maybe we could even do them, probably we're even gonna do them in batches, so we're not gonna be generating one ball in the future, but like generating four or five at a time. So this could take an argument, like how many balls to generate. Or here, we can say how many times we wanna run a certain function, and probably that's not the most elegant way of writing all that stuff, but anyway, let's get going. So before we return the ball, we need to set these guys up. I wonder if there is any point in using data attributes at this point, because those balls are kind of like a one-time thing, really. We only care about those properties while they're being generated, and we don't really care about those properties except for time to live. So probably we don't need data properties for these things. So Width and height, that's gonna be based on that radius. We need some decent type of radius. Let's say the biggest a ball will be, oh god. Oh yeah, that's, of course, that's not locked in. No, that's too big. I wouldn't say more than 45. Yeah. So 42 pixels maximum. So radius will be between zero, no, no, between 10 and 42 or something. So let radius will be, we need a random value, so we can do a math.random, and actually we're gonna probably need to do a math.floor over the entire thing. So we're gonna floor the entire thing, and actually to be even, well, anyway, we can do that here. This is gonna be our radius here in pixels. And math.random returns a value between 0 and 1. So we wanna multiply that by a number equal to the maximum of the number we are willing to have, which was 42. Is that true? I haven't used that in a while. Seems alright. Seems alright. Yeah, we kinda need the lower value to be more than 10 at least, or something, or 8, whatever. So how do you do, how do you do, I could write it with a ternary and just say that if the number at the end is less than, I could do something like if this entire thing is less than 8, return, or, you know, but that doesn't seem efficient. There has to be a way to do minimum numbers with math.random. Why are they flooring also the max? I don't know. 0, 1, 2. Maybe that's the correct way of doing it. Get random min max. Okay, so they have actually a formula for that. So you multiply math.random by this formula. Seems straightforward, more or less, right? Instead of multiplying by I'm a little bit retarded. Let me see, what did I copy? I copied the entire expression, so just the multiplication part is this. And in my case, I can just kind of hard code the values for the time being. Oh, yeah, I can actually remove the sidebar there. Yeah, let's just go with this. Okay. It looks fine. Yeah. Cool. I have no idea if the widths are correct because they're just stacking on each other. So let's do the left and the right. Positioning of those balls. So width and height, cool. In the much the same fashion, which we can just calculate the left position to be something randomly selected between 0 and window.inner height. So the min here is 0, which makes this formula just a bit easier. Not that it was really hard. Mat floor, so 0 also can be a value which means that the balls will be cut off at the edges of the screen. If we wanted to do some detection, then we would need to minus from the minimum position, we would need to subtract the radius of the ball itself, but I'm not gonna go over that, no, not worth the extra hassle at this point. So min and max number, no, just the max number, and the max number in this case will be window inner height, simple as that. Inner width, I'm sorry. Absolutely the same thing for top position will be mat floor mat random times window inner height. Yeah. What the actual fuck? Okay, yeah, we're calculating the values, but we're not applying them. I think my brain is officially out for today, so let's apply those positions. Bow base. Because this is now encapsulated in this function, I can actually just use the term ball across, but which probably will be more elegant. Why does Visual Studio doesn't allow me to F2? Hello? Huh. Interesting. Oh, because we're just in a file. Okay, yeah, sure. Ball style, width, height, blah blah blah. Then let's set ball style dot left will be something. I don't remember. Did you have to add pixels to the style left? Probably. So left position in pixels, and then, well, style top will be top position in pixels. Okay, that's a whole lot better. Still boring AF. Cool. Now we have those also positioning, but we're not doing anything with time to live and so on. So to do, we're gonna implement this one tomorrow. Today it's time to live to make the balls actually disappear, and then to be able to generate new balls. The by far simplest solution is to set a self-destruct timer on the ball, so that whenever in 3 seconds the ball just gets removed from the DOM. But yeah, that's something we can think about tomorrow. I'm not gonna implement right now. What we can do before we wrap it up for the day is we can actually do the coloring. So, ball properties, radius, here it is, left, here it is, top, here it is. This needs to be done. Then width, height, left, top. Okay, so the background color, if we use RGBA, we can generate colors between 0 and 255. So that's probably the easiest, without coming up with some sort of a hex generator for here. We could also have like a prescribed list of colors, but I don't know if I want to go that way. So to keep things simple, we're just gonna say here, color. And we're gonna have let color equal something. Now, we can actually create here the whole string, so that in background color, I wonder if we should also have transparency. Sure. So RGBA values look like that. And then in here we need 3-comma separated values. So I could either write a function that basically returns those, or I could just generate the entire string here as a color and then just inject that here. And I think I'm gonna do that. Now, this will be a tagged template literal, so we can use some fancy features. So we can do expressions. So we're gonna have one expression here, one expression here, one expression here, red, green, blue, and then the alpha transparency. And the transparency value is easy because that goes just between 0 and 1. So this is literally gonna take in a math.random function with no added anything really. The other guys will need to be floored, and will need to have a min and a max number. And actually, they don't really need a min number is 0. If you floor a math random, the min number will always be 0. So in this case, math floor of math random times j 255. I wonder if, yeah, if it returns one, then it's gonna be 255 floor. That's legal. And then no pluses. Do I have an extra bracket here? Yeah. So, and that's actually the same thing three times, really. Kind of want three different values. Think that that might be it even. Okay, cool, I can live with that. I don't know if they have different opacity, it seems like they do. Yeah, they do. Cool. Pretty sweet. So, that's as far as we go today. Tomorrow, what is left to be done is okay, animation in background. That's mostly done, somewhat. But I would need to add like a logo and a name and background music. And yeah, and we can wrap this one up. Cool. See you guys tomorrow.